From the John DeVita Broadcast Center, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another broadcast of Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and Jack FM 89.7 WRHS Norwich on Thursday, June the 16th, the year 2016. And now, here he is, Mr. Fred Belcastro.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you.
Smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing.
When the sun comes shining through,
shining through.
When you're crying,
when you're crying,
you bring on the rain,
bring on the
stop
rain.
Your sighing,
stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling.
Keep on smiling,
keep on smiling,
and the world will smile.
Good morning and welcome once again to the Wealth and Wisdom program. My name is Fred Belcastro, your host, and during the next 30 minutes, we're going to be talking, discussing how we can use our wisdom to grow and protect our wealth. And as usual, we're fortunate to be able to broadcast from the John DeVita Broadcast Center here on the northwest side of Chicago. You, of course, are listening to us on Jack FM, 89.7 WRHS, out of Norwich, and I'm glad that you remembered that during the months of June and July, we're going to be heard Thursday mornings at 10:30 a.m. rather than our usual Friday morning. So just during the months of June and July, you're listening to us on WRHS, 89.7, Thursday mornings at 10:30. Today I want to talk and mention, in part, a conversation that I had with one of our listeners last week, talking about being too old a plan. But before that, before I get to that, I'd like to just reiterate what we left off, where we left off last week. And I know sometimes you're tired of hearing about the three types of money. I go over and over again talking about we only have three types of money. This is just to simplify it so that we put it, if we have to use a pie chart in our minds, that we segment and separate the amounts of dollars that we have. Remember, we have the accumulated money. We have the lifestyle money, the money that we use for our lifestyle. And then, of course, we have the money that I talk about that's so awfully important to us in our planning, the transferred money, the money that we're transferring away unknowingly and unnecessarily. And I repeat to say that if we actually knew where this money was going, of course we wouldn't be doing it. The importance of that, I'd like to just skip ahead just if I might for a moment. The importance of this transferred money in our planning. Again, a family earning $100,000 a year, saving $5,000 a year. They're saving 5% of their money. That's fine. That seems like a good thing to do. Leaves them $95,000 for everything else. They have a nice lifestyle, and they have some dollars that they're transferring. But by selecting investments with higher risk, assume the return on their dollars would be a 2% in today. If they 2 or 3%. If they earn 2% on their $5,000, how much is that? That's an additional $100 a year. Is that going to make a big difference in anybody's lifestyle? Is that going to change the way we live, the neighborhoods we live, the car we drive, the schools our children are going to? I don't think so. But what I talk about in the transferred funds is that if we reduce their expenses by just 2%, no, in other words, from the $95,000 a year that they're spending, by alleviating the unnecessary transfers, we just bring 2% back to the table. You know what that means on their $5,000? That's an additional $1,900 a year. So just to multiply $95,000 by 2% is $1,900 a year savings. A penny saved is a penny earned. Remember that. If we save 2% of the 95 by eliminating the unnecessary transfers, the wasteful transfers. Now, I'm not talking about keeping coins in your pocket, reducing your cell phone bills, just changing any of your lifestyle. I'm talking about the unnecessary transfers that we've talked about over and over again. I'll mention a few examples in just a moment. But that 2% of 95,000 gives us an additional 90. It's all dry. Isn't it boring to talk like this? The reason I do this is to put into your minds, to reinforce, to cement into your minds the importance of 1%, 2% saving, not interest earned. If I earn 2% on my 95,000 or my 5,000, that's $100. That's not going to change anything. But would $1,900 change anything? You see, $1,900 a year, would that change anything? Oh, you like the figures? You like the arithmetics of the numbers? That $1,900 a year is an equivalent to a 38% additional rate of return on your saving. 38% additional rate of return. You like to talk about over the water cooler, over a cup of coffee at McDonald's, sitting around the table? You like to talk about earning 2%, 3%? How about 38% with no additional risk? No additional risk of your dollars. Now, where do we have some of those major wealth transfers? I've said it over and over again. Major wealth transfers, the taxes you pay. Once you pay the taxes, what happens to the money? Is it gone? Completely. It'll never return to you. These dollars are spent. Any dollar that you send on in the form of a tax that's unnecessary because of improper planning is gone forever. And then remember the lost opportunity? It's not only that dollar that you lose, but what that dollar would have earned for you had you had it working for you. All right, how about financing cars? We've gone through this illustration. We'll do that sometime in the future as well. Do I have to tell you about 12 to 18% on credit cards? Talk each and every week, transfer dollars. How much are you paying in transfer fees to the credit card companies? Why do they keep sending you bill after bill after bill, opportunity? You know what? Every time I receive an envelope from this bank, that bank, or whatever, it's another opportunity to transfer balances, to do this, to do. Why? Because it's a way for them to make money, a tremendous amount of money. We did the arithmetic on this, I think, about a year ago or something like that. It came to be at 18% on the money that we transferred to them, something like in the millions of dollars from each individual account. How about the wrong mortgages? How about paying our mortgage? How about the way we're handling the mortgage expenses? Remember, several months ago we did a comparison between an arm of an adjustable rate mortgage, a 15-year mortgage, a 30-year mortgage. How did that work out? Do you recall what those figures came to be? How about the life insurance we plan? Do we have the wrong kind? Are we misled? Where do we get most of our information? We get a lot of information from books written by people who are, wait a second, what do they write the books for? Oh, that's how they earn a living. Oh, they earn a living by writing a book. All right, so I can tell people then to buy this type of insurance and you'll save this amount of money, and now that makes me a financial guru. But many of individuals have the wrong type of life insurance. How about the deductibles? You're still carrying a $100 deductible, a $250 deductible, a $500 deductible? Have you looked at the difference between what the deductible of a $500 deductible premium is compared to a $1,000 deductible? Guess what? Figure it out. You're pretty near paying what that deductible is. You're pretty near paying that $500 extra in premiums. Take a look at those things. We did one a few months ago with just the deductibles it qualified her to get her supplemental Medicare and with no additional out-of-pocket costs to her. You see, just helping. Let's attach some wisdom to our planning. How do we go about buying those big ticket items? Do we walk into H.H. Gregg and just plop down the place across the street and Best Buy, plop down a piece of plastic? How about when we go up the steps or we go over to Carson's or one of the other department stores. We just give them that piece of plastic and we'll pay it off in 20 years. You mean to tell me that I buy a pair of socks or my wife buys me a pair of socks and I'm going to pay juice on that pair of socks for the next 20 years? You see, how do we make some of these purchases? How do we make some of the major purchases? As I mentioned, the H.H. Gregg. You go in there, you got some nice machines, some nice washing machines, some nice barbecue grills, some nice technological TVs going, and big screen, 5 foot, 10 foot, you know, screens you could probably just walk right into and take part in the programs that are running. But how do we pay for all that? Well, all you got to do is plop down that piece of plastic and smile as whatever it is that's happening to you, and take your big ticket purchase right out with you. And then there are individuals that said, hey, listen, I save, I've got this account, I've got this CD account, and every week or every month or biweekly, I go and add to my CD account, and it accumulates and accumulates and accumulates. And I say, stop, look at the arithmetic. Let's stop. Are we wasting a lot of money in doing that? Are we putting our money into fixed returns? Not that they're bad. I'm not saying that they're bad. But with inflation and taxation on these accounts, we're actually losing money. One of the biggest things, back in 1980, I was doing seminars, and up on the screen, I'd have an example of the wonderful rates of return that we're getting. We're getting 10, 11, 12% on CDs. Remember, not only would we get 10, 11, 12% on our CDs, we were getting, ready for this? We were getting an iron, so we can iron the clothes. We were getting toasters. You see, we're getting clocks. So, man, what a deal that we're not only are we getting 10, 12% on our CD money, but we're getting a toaster. You know. And then you'd stop and think. At that time, ladies and gentlemen, the highest tax rate was 70% marginal rates. So the average guy was still paying 10, 15, 20% taxes. So he got 20% tax, and on a 10% rate of return, and in addition to that, because of the politics that was going on in the country, our inflation rate was 12-13%. Can you put a pencil to that and see where we were actually losing money? We were paying big time for those toasters, and it's still the same way today. Inflation 2 or 3%. We're earning 1%. We're paying taxes on the 1% in a 30% marginal tax bracket. You don't need me to figure that out. We're on the losing end. We're on the losing end. But I want to get to too old to plan in just a few minutes. But for months I've used this, and those of you who know me well know about four-letter words. And one of the most famous four-letter words I like is work. I mean, we don't apply that four-letter word to enough of the situations, but one of the four-letter words that I'll apply is plan, P-L-A-N, simple word. Do we plan? I remember about a month, 6, 8 weeks ago, we took the lawnmower out of the garage, and it's a gas lawnmower, and we brought it to Russo's to get a tune-up, and we had the blades sharpened and had the spark plugs changed, and just had the filters changed in it to make certain that it's going to give us the service that we need over the next few months. But we had to plan that. Well, how many of us plan? How many of us have planned our assets? How many of us, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the highest, saying that we're doing fine in our planning, we're doing fine in the accumulating of our assets in order to live at the end of the line, when we reach those golden years, when we reach the time when we might even say it's too old, we're too old to plan? How many of us can answer some of these questions? But before I get to that, why don't we just take a few minutes, give me a chance to get a cup of coffee, calm down, and listen to this.
Till finché lassù c'è il sol, radioso di splendor, vivrà per noi l'amor, till finché il chiaror lunar gli amanti fa vibrar, potrò con te sognare. Sono tua, till sin quando c'è il calor che scalderà due cuor, saprò cos'è l'amor. Quando c'è il calor che scalderà due cuor, saprò cos'è l'amore.
That beautiful song was sung by Caterina Valente. And if we didn't understand all the words were for our ears, the music was for our souls. So I'm sure you felt it just as I. Caterina Valente in the song Till from 1957. All right, our accumulated money, 1 to 10 on the scale, 1 to 10, 10 being the highest. Where would we rate ourselves? And I've said this over and over again. These are our dollars. These are our important dollars. These are the dollars that we've put away for ourselves and those of those people we love. And we get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and we shovel the snow and we start the car and we do all that. And I'd ask you then, how long are you going to continue doing that so that you can retire at your present standard of living? What rate of return? What are you earning on your money? Oh, I know you're getting a quarter, 1%, a half a percent, or whatever you want to talk about on the CDs or what the current bank rates are. But what percent are you earning on your dollars? On the important dollars, the accumulated dollars, what rate of return? Do you know what your rate of return is? Take me 10 minutes. Give me some figures. I can figure it out in 10 minutes for you. What rate of return will you have to earn on your retired savings in order to live at your present lifestyle at retirement? And of course, then once you figure those out, you know how much you could spend when you retire, and you'll know how much money you have to last to your life expectancy, and then how much you'll be able to gift and give to your children or leave for your children or nieces or nephews. What are some of your options? And this brings us to, I'm too old to plan, P-L-A-N, and there it is, another four-letter word that we don't like. What other options do you have? Well, I don't know. Well, what is it? I just got my Social Security, some small government pension, or that's it? You get a gold watch and you're told to enjoy your life on Social Security and maybe the small benefits from a 401k, and that's it? How can you improve what you're doing? And that brings us to the conversation I had with one of our listeners last week. By the way, if you'd like to comment on some of the things that we talk about, our phone number is area 630-673-4360. Or as some of you like to do, email. Send me an email, fbelsecure@aol.com. fbelsecure@aol.com. But some of the questions that we talked about, being too old a plan, how old is too old? Is it 55? I've had clients that retired at 55, completely happy. One client just recently has a condo in Florida, two condos in Florida, and a home here, just enjoying themselves, going between the snowbird kind of environment, but just enjoying themselves. That's what you want to do, isn't it? Whether or not you stay here at home in the Chicagoland area at 55 or travel around the country, around the world, that should be your privilege. That should be the reason why you pull the cart through the mud for the last 40 years. So too old a plan? No, you're not too old a plan at 50, 55, 60, even the 70. Because there are certain things that have to be taken into consideration during these years. Big, big, important things that could make all the difference in how you enjoy your retirement and have a sufficient amount of money. One of those things, of course, is what's the consequence of me taking a lump sum for my 401? Should I take a lump sum payment, or should I take distribution? Should I roll that over, that 401, into an individual IRA and take control of that money myself? Can I leave it with my company? Can we look at this, folks? Can we look at this prior to the day we walk into our boss's office or into human resources office? Can we just do a little bit of planning so when the time comes, we can answer those questions to our benefit, not detriment, to our benefit? How about what does it cost me? What do I have to do if my wife's still living? I want to take a joint life option on my pension. Is that available? Do I have a joint life pension? 10 years certain, 15 years certain, 20 years certain, life in? What are my options? Could I look at those now? Well, my wife and I are sitting here and discussing it, and I'm sitting here with the people I care about, and we all discuss it and how it's going to affect our future over the next 20 or 30 years. Oh yeah, don't forget, 65 to 95 now is 30 years. We're living longer and longer, so these things have to be planned for. There's that four-letter word again. How about if I take the single payout, which is the highest? I just leave my wife off it completely. How do I arrange benefits for her? How is she going to be taken care of if something happens to me and we forfeit the pension? Big point to plan. If I convert my IRA to a Roth, you know, a Roth is tax-free after 5 years, after 59 and a half. So there are a lot of benefits in receiving tax-free money. Remember we talked about tax-deferred, tax-free, tax-qualified? All these things have a large portion to play in our retirement and during the accumulation phase. Remember, again, accumulation phase, distribution phase, totally, totally, totally different. So you're never too old to plan, especially in the distribution plan the arrangement. There's not going to be another 40 years, my friends. We see, when you reach 65 or 70 years old, you're not 25, 30. I don't have to tell you this, but there's no accumulation. If there is, there's not much accumulation because you're not working or have the health to work or the ability to work or the plan to the place to work at. So what are the tax implications if I convert some of my taxables to tax-free at that point? And I'm still not certain whether or not I should just take my pension in full or take a lump sum. Somebody's telling me take a lump sum. Somebody's telling me another thing. I have another brother-in-law. Remember when we started this show years ago, we talked about the famous brother-in-laws. Listen, I can go into any, right about 9:30, 10 o'clock, I can go into any McDonald's around the Norwich area, or Burger King or whatever, and listen to all kinds of good advice. This guy's got this advice, that guy. Go to Harlem Irving Plaza, sit in their food court in the morning. You'll get all kinds of advice. But what's going to be best for you? Have you planned? Have you looked at it? Why don't we give me a break and let's listen to these fellas once again, some of our favorites.
Make it mine.
Make it mine.
Please make it mine.
Three coins in the fountain, each one seeking happiness, thrown by three hopeful lovers, which one will the fountain bless? Three hearts in the fountain, each heart longing for its home. There they lie in the fountain, somewhere in the heart of Rome. Which one will the fountain bless? Which one will the fountain bless? In the fountain, through the ripples, how they shine. Just one wish will be granted. One heart will wear a valentine. Make it mine, make it mine, make it mine. Just one wish will be granted. One heart will wear a valentine. Make it mine, make it mine, make it mine.
From 1954, the Four Aces singing Three Coins in the Fountain, from that movie, Three Coins in the Fountain, the same movie. That, I think that was their number one hit, took them and skyrocketed them to radio fame. Again, planning required minimum distributions. We know we have to take those sometime after or before we're beyond 70 and a half. And we know how much we have to withdraw. We're given letters from various companies that we have our 401s with, the distributions. We know that we're penalized up to 50% on the dollars that we don't take out, so it's important to make those withdrawals. Why are they important to make those withdrawals? Because of the taxes, my friend. Don't forget, the government has allowed us to defer, not save anything, defer the taxes until that and the pot grew large enough. Then they figured the population, as it turns 70 and a half, has a big enough pot to start taking chunks of taxation out, taxes out. At what rate? Well, we don't know. Remember, you can take this money, defer it, not pay taxes on it. Oh, whoopee, whoopee. Isn't that great? And then at the end of the line, what do I have to pay you back? Oh, I don't know. The government says, well, we'll figure it out then. We had Kathleen singing till then, you know. Till then, we're going to have to pay our taxes. At what rate? Can they change it to 40%? Yeah. Can they change it to 50? Yeah. They could do whatever they want to do with it. How about the income analysis? We're not 59 and a half. Can we take that money out before we reach age 59 and a half without a penalty? You know, if we take it out too soon, have enough taxes due by letting it accumulate to age 65 or 70, we'll have to pay a 10% penalty tax that our government sells that to us by telling us they want to make certain that we're taken care of. I'm sure they do. But can we get away without paying that 10% penalty tax? Yeah, 72T, everybody knows about it. You should know about it, and it should be part of your planning. At least giving it some consideration. And, of course, inflation. Those of us who are receiving Social Security checks know that there hasn't been any inflation the last couple of years. We're very fortunate and thankful of that. No inflation because our checks haven't increased. That's okay, though, because what was that medication? $400 a pill? You got people that are undergoing cancer treatments, and they told me it was like $1,200. I was at the gym last week. Somebody told me the pill was $1,200 just for one pill. This individual was well-fixed, well-to-do, had insurance, Medicaid supplements in place, and only paid several hundred dollars, was able to afford it. But for those individuals that didn't plan, that don't have the money, I don't know what that means. It just means it's just a terrible situation to be in. And that's why I say, let's plan. It'll cost you maybe a couple hundred dollars to figure this all out. Do it. It's well worth it. All right. Speaking of things that are well worth it, our time is just about up. And I want to leave you as I usually do. I want to thank you for listening. Thank you for the great support you're giving WRHS 89.7 here in Norridge. The phone calls that we get, again, area 630-673-4360 and FBell Secure, an email, fbellsecure@aol.com. But listen, in the days to come, a lot of lawn work, a lot of yard work to be done, a lot of clippings, a lot of hedges to be trimmed and pruned. Why don't we have a neighbor down the street that maybe isn't doing as well as we are physically, and why don't we lend a hand? Make somebody smile, make somebody feel good, be kind to one another, and let's smile.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you.
Smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing.
Mm, when the sun comes shining through,
shining through.
When you're crying,
when you're crying,
you bring on the rain.
Bring on the
stop
rain.
Your sighing.
Stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling.
When you're smiling.
Keep on smiling.
Keep on smiling.
And the world will smile.
You have been listening to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich. And the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Thursday, June 16th, the year 2016. This broadcast was directed by John DeVita. Our special thanks to radio station manager Kevin Zeflik of WRHS-FM Norwich and the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network, Mr. John Secondo. Until next time, please, be safe, and thanks for listening. This broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, June the 15th, the year 2016. And this is Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM, Norridge, Illinois. Have a safe and wonderful weekend, everyone.